بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله العظيم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو حي لا يموت، بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ رسالة ونصح للأمة وكشف الغمة وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك، فعليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. آمين يا رب العالمين. وأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل، وقد أمرنا بالحق وقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال تعالى: يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. وقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد، we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bearing witness that none has the right to be worshipped or unconditionally obeyed except for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Him to send His peace and blessings upon our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family, his companions, and those that follow until the Day of Judgment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst them. Allahumma ameen. Dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, in a very beautiful, you know, group of ayat that you'll often hear many people speaking of and many different angles from these ayat because of how powerful and impactful these ayat can be. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Oh my servants who have wasted themselves in sin, been extravagant with themselves, لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ, don't despair from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all sins, overlooks all sins. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-ghafoor, He is the all-forgiving, He is the most compassionate. Now the problem is that we usually fail to go beyond these ayat and read the next 5 ayat, the next 6 ayat, which in essence are a call to action. And this is a very, very important feature of the Qur'an. Every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a ibrah in the Qur'an, every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a wake-up call in the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala follows it up with a call to action. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala follows it up with a call to change course. So every time, as the scholars say, every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اعلموا, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does such and such, or know that اعلموا أن الله يحيي الأرض بعد موتها, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives life even to the dead ground. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every time He gives you this call, the very next ayah is a call to amal, is a call to action, is a call to change course. And so with this ayah in particular, and there's no doubt that there's much beauty in this ayah in and of itself. أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ, people who have wasted themselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, never despair from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all sins. And the idea here, as Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala, he said beautifully, he said, إِنَّ الذَّنْبَ إِذَا صَغُرَ عِنْدَكَ, that verily, whenever a sin becomes small in your eyes, كَبُرَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ, it becomes very large in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you take a sin and you belittle that sin, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to warn us from مُحَقَّرَاتُ الذُّنُوبِ, belittling sins. The more that you belittle a sin, you can take a small sin, but you belittle that sin, the greater that sin becomes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then on the other hand, he says, the more that that them,
becomes large in your eyes, the more serious you take that sin, the more insignificant it becomes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so you could take the smallest sin, and because of your utter disregard for that sin, as Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah gave the very beautiful example. He said, you know, if you take a small drip of water, and you allow it to, or you take some water and you allow that water to continuously drip in small drips on the same spot on even a hard stone, eventually it will erode the entire stone. It will kill your heart. And it is such a shame that a person lacks that hayat with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that modesty with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where this sin doesn't even matter anymore to me. Even if it's something small. As the Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah said, لَا تَنْظُرْ إِلَى الذَّنْبِ. He said, don't look at the size of the sin. لَكِنْ أُنْظُرْ إِلَى مَنْ عَصَيْتِ. Look at the one who you disobeyed. Look at al-kabir, al-azim. Who you had no shame in disobeying. And that's really what the factor should be in this entire process of tawbah. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهُ. Those who, whenever they commit a shameless act of sin, or whenever they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or find themselves in any form of transgression, they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't start to think about the other stuff. Maybe there are secondary factors. But the first thing is dhakarullah. Who have I sinned against? How dare I have the audacity to sin against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while He's watching me, while He provides for me. In fact, using the things that He provided for me in a land that He has created right in front of Him without any shame anymore. Right? And that is a very, very, very dangerous state to get to. And even if it's a very small sin, as Abu Jandal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, إِن كُنْتُمْ تَرَوْنَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَرَاكُمْ. If you see that Allah doesn't see you when you sin, maybe you just don't know that Allah is watching you. فَأَنْتُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ بِهِ. That is a form of shirk. If you're not even believing that Allah is watching you when you commit a sin, then that's a form of shirk. وَإِن كُنْتُمْ تَرَوْنَ أَنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ. And if you come to the realization Allah is watching you, فَلِمَ جَعَلْتُمُ اللَّهِ. Why did you make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala أَهْوَنَ النَّاظِرِينَ إِلَيْكَ. The lowest of your observers. Didn't you have any shame? The lowest of your observers. You would be ashamed of the sin in front of people, but not in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أُنظُرْ إِلَى مَنْ عَصَيْتَ. Who is the one that you have disobeyed? Consider that. Don't consider the size of the sin. Why? Because as Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated, that the believer sees his sin as a mountain, as a burden on his back. Whereas the fasiq, the wicked one, just sees it like a fly on his nose. He just brushes it off. He brushes it away. He doesn't care. Right? So that's how the believer sees his sins. But then on the other hand, if you see that sin as so great that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can't forgive you, then you've entered into another dangerous realm. And this is an Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, who is the one who is saying, look at the one who you've disobeyed, not at the size of the sin. Look at the incredible balance of these people. As he is dying, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, oh my Lord, I have realized that I have committed many sins. I've put forth much ma'asi, many forms of disobedience. I have many sins on my record. But then I recognize that you, with a little bit of your mercy, you can take care of a lot of my sins. So, O Allah, do away with my sins with just a little bit of your mercy. A little bit of the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is enough for an entire body of sins. It's enough for an entire world of sins. A little bit of mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the incredible balance these people have. Right? I mean, you're talking about al-khawf wa-raja, fear and hope. And subhanAllah, as Ar-Raja ibn Haywa said, that the believer lives his life in fear, and then at the time of al-ihtilah, at the time when he's leaving this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows hope to overcome him. He knows, right? He knows. He knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is fully capable of forgiving him, and that Allah's mercy is greater than his sins. And so again, the more that you consider your sin, the more insignificant it becomes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if it's a murder of 100 people, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us that story from Bani Israel. It's not a fable. That's true. Even if it's something that big. And that's why Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, two people walk to him in the same setting. Two people come to him. The first person comes to him and says, if I've killed a man, will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ever forgive me? And he told him, yes, Allah will forgive you. And then another person comes and asks him the same question while he's sitting in the same chair. SubhanAllah, I mean, he is as he is. Same day, same people around him. If I've killed someone, will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ever forgive me? He said, no. So the people around him asked him when he left, they said, you know, why is it that you gave two different answers? He said, because the first guy that came actually killed someone and felt bad about it. So there was a true sense of repentance. There was a true sense of nadam. And he wanted to know if he'd ever be capable of being forgiven. So I told him yes. He said, the second guy wanted to kill somebody. He was coming to ask for a license to kill. SubhanAllah, think about that. That's why and there are a lot of people that their hearts become so hard, they reduce Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his observing of them to the point that they can plan sins. Like, I know I'm going to commit a sin a week from today. And I'm not, you know, there's no swaying in this. I'm going to do this and I'm going to commit the sin. Khalas, it's already written on paper. I have determined to commit the sin. And there's no shame in them. Right? There's no shame that holds you back. At least, you know, maybe a few hours you'll think about it. Maybe a day you'll feel some shame. But a person can just keep on going up. Allah is Ghafoor Rahim. That's not who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about. And that's why the next few ayats, وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ. Turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At-tawbah comes from inaba. It's actually turning around. Change course. Turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مِنْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ. And submit yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On His terms. مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابِ ثُمَّ لَا تُنْصَرُونَ. Before the punishment comes to you. Before the punishment comes to you, and you will not be helped, you will not be supported at that time, you will not find anyone, any wali, anyone to come to your aid on the Day of Judgment. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّبِعُوا أَحْسَنَ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. Don't play around with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't condition your tawbah. Don't try to find loopholes. Don't try to find fatawa that justify your sin. وَاتَّبِعُوا أَحْسَنَ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. Follow the revelation. The best of that which was given to you. مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابُ بَغْتَةً. Before the adab comes to you, before that punishment comes to you suddenly. وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. You didn't even see it coming. Now you know the beauty of these ayat? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us here, and pay attention to this. Allah azza wa jalla is giving us here the warnings in dunya. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fast forwards to the akhirah. The way that those people who did not heed the warnings will be in the akhirah. So the first one who managed to despair from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah said, لَقَدْ خَابَ وَخَسَرْ مَنْ خَرَجَ عَنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ الَّتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. How miserable is a human being that manages to escape the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, although it is all encompassing, it encompasses everything. And he still managed to miss the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That person who Allah called upon not to despair, what is his situation in the akhirah? أَن تَقُولَ نَفْسٌ يَا حَسْرَةَ عَلَى مَا فَرَّطُ فِي جَنْبِ اللَّهِ وَإِنْ كُنْتُ لَمِنَ السَّاخِرِينَ. He's calling upon, he's saying, يَا حَسْرَةَ. You know, and this is a statement of destruction. And nadam is a healthy regret in this dunya. Hasra is a regret that you never come back from. It's remorse, it's over. يَا حَسْرَةَ. Oh, how I messed, how could I have associated that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How bad did I mess up? وَإِنْ كُنْتُ لَمِنَ السَّاخِرِينَ. And I remember fully that I was from as-sakhirin. I was from those that used to make a mockery of this message. I remember fully. And subhanAllah, he despairs in dunya and Allah says this personality type is one of despair even in akhirah. When he recognizes he's messing up, he doesn't make any changes. And likewise, on the Day of Judgment, he has recognized he's messing up, he just goes into a mode of defeat. Ya hasrata. Oh, how I messed up. You know, how could I do that? How did I allow myself to be amongst those people? And he will live his entire eternity in that hasra. That's a personality type that Allah is saying is a personality type that leads to failure. A person that whenever they recognize that they're, you know, there's some people who when they recognize that they're doing something wrong, whether it's worldly or it's a matter of the hereafter, they turn around. They make those changes. Some people just get worse and worse and worse and worse. Because that's in essence what Shaytan does. That's in essence what Iblis does. Iblis gets worse and worse and worse and worse. He cries. Rasulullah said he cries. Sahih Muslim. That whenever he sees the son of Adam making sujood, اعتزل الشيطان يبكي يقول أمر بالسجود فسجد وأمرت فعصي. When he sees you and I making sujood, Iblis, when he sees us making sujood, and it's not like he never made sujood before, he made sujood for thousands of years. But what does he do? He doesn't make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He goes to a corner and cries. He cries about it. He despairs. And he says he was commanded to make sujood and he responded, I was commanded and I disobeyed. And he gets worse and worse and worse and worse. Every single day. He doesn't turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are some people you say, ittaqillah, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they're falling short in one obligation. You know what Iblis comes to you? Shaytan comes to you and tries to make you fall short in every other obligation too. Why are you fasting? You don't even pray on time. Stop fasting. You know, why are you going to go to Hajj? Don't you know that you have some haram money that's waiting for you? So instead of give up the haram money to go to Hajj, don't go to Hajj. How can you come back to haram money? Astaghfirullah. Right? Don't do this. Don't do that. Don't do that. Look at you. Look at how pitiful you are. He makes you despair because that's what he does and that's who he is. That's who he is. You don't change because you have decided to fail. And that's not the way the believer is supposed to be. Whenever you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know you have a Lord that is Haleem, a Lord that is forbearing, a Lord that is Ghafoor, a Lord that overlooks. Change. All you have to do is give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something to forgive you with. You know, give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something. Make some kind of effort. And you never know, you might be like that man who killed 100 people. Right? And all he had was that he was on his way to make tawbah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy is that much. Now what about the second warning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave? وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ. Hurry up and change course and submit yourself to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابِ ثُمَّ لَا تُنْصَرُونَ. Before punishment comes to you and then you won't be helped. There are some people that are accustomed to being dependent upon others. Meaning what? You know, if I'm messing up, well at least everyone else is messing up too. You know, I can call upon this person. When I get in trouble, someone else is going to bail me out. Right? That person that's dependent upon other people. If the people go this way, he goes that way. If the people go this way, he goes that way. As Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said, you should not be a person of no character. Saying that if the people do this, I'll go that way. If the people do this, I'll go that way. Rather, you should get used to the idea that if everyone on earth disbelieved, I would still believe. You should accustom yourself to that. But you're just looking, you're making sure that you're maintaining status quo. So if the people are disobeying Allah, I'm disobeying Allah too. If I mess up, I'll call somebody, they can help me if it's dunya, whatever it is. A person that is du'af, that is da'if. Al-du'afa wal-ladhina istakbaru. Allah says, day of judgment, there will be weak people and those people that were full of pride in dunya. And the weak people are still calling out to al-ladhina istakbaru. الَّذِينَ تُبِعُوا وَالَّذِينَ تَبَعُوا. The followers and the leaders, they're still calling out and saying, can you get us out of this situation? Why did you do this to us? Why did you lead us to this? They're still not taking ownership of their own problems or holding their own selves accountable. And what is the second warning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَوْ تَقُولَ لَوْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ هَدَانِي لَكُنْتُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. On the day of judgment, this person is so used to not taking ownership of his own self and his own actions. What will he say? Or he will say, if Allah would have guided me, then I would have been from the muttaqeen. Why didn't you guide me, O Allah? If Allah would have guided me. You see that level of arrogance that a person has? That refusal to take ownership of your own actions? Blame this person. Blame my parents. Who amongst the Sahaba had Muslim parents? Blame my society. What about Salman al-Farisi? What about Suhaib al-Rumi? Right? Blame this, blame that. Some people will always find others to blame. Some people will always find others to blame.
And even if that means blaming Allah, the way Shaytan blamed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he said, Bima aghwaytani, the way you led me astray, I'm going to lead all of them astray. So at least Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be a nafs al-lawwama. At least a person who blames himself, who admonishes himself, who takes accountability of his deeds, does not blame Allah, does not blame the people, does not blame Shaytan, blames himself, and says, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Oh Allah, we wronged ourselves. If you don't forgive us and have mercy on us, then we're going to be losers. You know, you imagine, this dua, Adam alayhi salam was attributing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the quality of forgiveness and his complete dependence upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, while not deflecting any of the blame on Allah or any of the blame on Shaytan. Whereas Shaytan was not giving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala any credit, not that Allah needs his credit, while completely deflecting the blame to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so this person number two, did not heed warning number two. And the third one, وَاتَّبِعُوا أَحْسَنَ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابُ بَغْتَةً وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. Hurry up and follow the guidance that was given to you before the punishment comes to you suddenly. وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. And you're not going to feel it when it comes. What is that person's state on the Day of Judgment? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, warning number three, situation number three. أَوْ تَقُولَ حِينَ تَرَى الْعَذَابُ. Or he would say when he sees the punishment, لَوْ أَنَّ لِي كَرَّةً فَأَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. If I had another chance, not only would I be a mu'min, like the first one, not only would I be a muttaqi, someone who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَأَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. I know I was capable, but I was procrastinating. I was waiting, right? I kept thinking to myself, I'll make tawbah before I die. I'm still young, I've still got my whole life ahead of me. I was procrastinating. Now that he understands he had the capability. He understands Allah provided him the means of guidance. And now he sees the fire in front of his face, and that's the only time he wakes up. That's not how the believer is. You don't wait until the punishment comes to you. And he said, لَأَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, meaning I would worship Allah as if I could see him, because now I know I've been taken from knowledge to sight. علم اليقين تعين اليقين, right, in worship. The knowledge, certain knowledge, and then actually seeing it for myself. And the believer worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that way now. He worships Allah as if he can see paradise in hellfire. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our shortcomings. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to make us amongst those who have destructive flaws or destructive personalities. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who, whenever they wrong themselves, make istighfar, take ownership, and turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a better way than we were before. Allahumma ameen. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر لي ولكم ونساء المسلمين فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين والعاقبة للمتقين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters, in conclusion, I only leave you with what Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu said about Suhayb al-Rumi radiallahu anhu, who came to the lands of Arabia as a slave and who had no exposure to guidance previous to that whatsoever. But as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, this person from Rome surpassed all of the Arabs in guidance, surpassed everyone in guidance. And who worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in such a way that Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu once made a remark about him. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu said about Suhayb, لَوْ لَا يَخَافُ اللَّهِ لَمْ يَعْصِهِ. If he didn't fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he still wouldn't disobey him. Because of the amount of love, how great Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to Suhayb. As you know, and subhanAllah, that's what's missing here. Considering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshipping him as if you can see him, gives you a sense of urgency. That way you don't depend on other people. Knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will blame yourself. You will never blame Allah or blame circumstances, because Allah has given you enough to be guided. And you act with a sense of urgency. And if that happens inside of you,
If you have that sense of urgency and your heart is viewing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, although your eyes cannot, then everything changes. As Salih ibn Kaysan, rahimahullah, said to the father of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said to Abdul Aziz, he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَلَّهُ أَعْظَمُ فِي صَدْرِهِ مِنْ هَذَا الْغُلَامِ. I've never seen anyone to whom Allah is greater in his chest. How great is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you than this young man? Because that produces a reaction. That produces a reaction. And when we look at these three personality types that I just mentioned, the warning that came from Allah and their state on the Day of Judgment, we have to ask ourselves if we have anything from those personalities. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to rid us of anything that is displeasing to Him. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us and have mercy upon us and overlook our shortcomings, because His mercy is greater than our sins and greater than our shortcomings. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who long for Him and who long for meeting Him and who prepare themselves for that meeting. Allahumma ameen. Allahumma khfir al-mu'mineen wal-mu'minat wal-muslimin wal-muslimat al-ahya'i minhum wal-amwat innaka sami'un qareebun mujeebu da'wat. Allahumma khfir lana warhamna wa'afu anna wala tu'adhibna. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم اغفر لوالدينا رب ارحمهما كما ربونا صغارا. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في الشام. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في سوريا وفي فلسطين وفي برما وفي العراق وفي أفغانستان وفي الشيشان وفي الصومال وفي السودان وفي إثيوبيا وفي باكستان وفي كل مكان. اللهم عليك بأعدائك أعداء الدين. اللهم أرنا فيهم عجائب قدرتك يا قوي يا عزيز. اللهم أهلك الظالمين بالظالمين وأخرجنا من بينهم سالمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعماء يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.